Book 2, Part 5 of De Smet's Letters and Sketches, 1841 to 1842, by Father Pierre Jean de Smet. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Narrative of a year's residence among the Indian tribes of the Rocky Mountains. The savages who principally frequent the borders of the Columbia River are from the lakes, the chief of whom, with several of the nation, have been baptized. Also the Shuyelpi or Chaudières, the Okanagans, Singpoils, Walla Wallas, Pierced Noses, Cayuses, Atayas, Spokanes, the Indians from the Falls and Cascades, and the Chinooks and Clatsops. We arrived at Fort Vancouver on the morning of the 8th June. I enjoyed the happiness and great consolation of meeting, in these distant parts, two respectable Canadian priests, the Reverend Mr. Blanchet, Grand Vicar of all the countries west of the mountains claimed by the British Crown, and the Reverend Mr. Demers. They are laboring in these regions for the same object that we are trying to accomplish in the Rocky Mountains. The kindness and benevolence with which these reverend gentlemen received me are proofs of the pure zeal which actuates them for the salvation of these savages. They assured me that immense good might be done in the extensive regions that border on the Pacific if a greater number of missionaries, with means at their command, were stationed in these regions, and they urged me very strongly to obtain from my superiors some of our fathers. I will try to give you in my next some extracts from the letters of these missionaries, which will make the country known to you, its extent, and the progress of their mission. The governor of the Honorable Company of Hudson Bay, Dr. McLaughlin, who resides at Fort Vancouver, after having given me every possible proof of interest as a good Catholic, advised me to do everything in my power to gratify the wishes of the Canadian missionaries. His principal reason is that if Catholicity was rapidly planted in these tracts where civilization begins to dawn, it would be more quickly introduced thence into the interior. Already a host of ministers have overrun a part of the country and have settled wherever they may derive some advantages for the privations their philanthropy imposes on them. Such is the state of these regions of the New World, as yet so little known. You perceive that our prospects are by no means discouraging. Permit me, therefore, to repeat the great principle you have so often recommended to me, and which I have not forgotten, courage and confidence in God. With the mercy of God, the Church of Jesus Christ may soon have the consolation of seeing her standard planted in these distant lands on the ruins of idolatry and of the darkest superstition. Pray, then, that the Lord of such a rich harvest may send us numerous fellow laborers, for in so extensive a field we are but five, and beset with so many dangers, that at the dawn of day we have often reason to doubt whether we will live to see the sun go down. It is not that we have anything to fear from the climate, far from it, for if here death came only by sickness, we might indeed count upon many years, but water, fire, and the bow often hurry their victims off when least expected. Of 100 men who inhabit this country, there are not 10 who do not die by some or other fatal accident. The afternoon of the 30th June, I resumed my place in one of the barges of the English company and took my leave of the worthy and respectable governor. To my great joy, I found that the Reverend Mr. Demers was one of the passengers, being about to undertake an apostolic excursion among the different tribes of New Caledonia, who, according to the accounts of several Canadian travelers, were most anxious to see a black gown and hear the word of God. The wind being favorable, the sails of the barge were unfurled, and the sailors plying their oars at the same time, the 11th of July saw us landed safely at Fort Walla Walla. The next day I parted with many regrets from my esteemed friends, Reverend Mr. Demers and Mr. Ogden. Accompanied only by my interpreter, we continued our land route to the 19th, through woods and immense plains. The high plains which separate the waters of the Snake River from those of the Spokane offer some natural curiosities. I fancied myself in the vicinity of several fortified cities, surrounded by walls and small forts, scattered in different directions. The pillars are regular pentagons, from 2 to 4 feet in diameter, erect, joined together, forming a wall from 40 to 80 feet high, and extending several miles in the form of squares and triangles, detached from one another and in different directions. On our road we met some pierced noses and a small band of Spokans, who accosted us with many demonstrations of friendship, and, although very poor, offered us more salmon than we could carry. The Pointed Hearts, a tribe which shall ever be dear to me, came to meet us, and great was the joy on both sides on beholding one another again. They had strictly observed all the rules I had laid down for them at my first visit. They accompanied me for 3 days to the very limits of their territory. We then planted a cross on the summit of a high mountain covered with snow, and after the example of the Flatheads, all the people consecrated themselves inviolably to the service of God. We remained there that night. The next morning, after reciting our prayers in common and giving them a long exhortation, we bade them farewell. The 20th, I continued my journey over terrific mountains, steep rocks, and through apparently impenetrable forests. I could scarcely believe that any human being had ever preceded us over such a road. At the end of 4 days' journey, replete with fatigue and difficulties, we reached the borders of the Bitterroot River, and on the evening of the 27th, I had the happiness of arriving safely at St. Mary's and of finding my dear brethren in good health. The Flatheads, accompanied by Father Point, had left the village 10 days before to procure provisions. A few had remained to guard the camp, and their families awaited my return. The 29th I started to rejoin the Flatheads on the Missouri River. We ascended the Bitterroot to its source, and the 1st of August, having clambered up a high mountain, we planted a cross on its very summit, near a beautiful spring, one of the sources of the Missouri. The next day, after a forced march, we joined the camp where we had such a budget of news to open, so many interesting facts to communicate to each other, that we sat up a greater part of the night. The Reverend Father Point and myself accompanied our dear neophytes, who, to obtain their daily bread, are obliged to hunt the buffalo, even over the lands of their most inveterate enemies, the Blackfeet. On the 15th of August, the Feast of the Assumption, the same on which this letter is dated, I offered up the sacrifice of the Mass in a noble plain watered by one of the 3 streams that form the headwaters of the Missouri, to thank God for all the blessings He had bestowed on us during this last year. I had the consolation of seeing 50 Flatheads approach the Holy Table in so humble, modest, and devout a manner that, to my perhaps partial eye, they resembled angels more than men. On the same day I determined, for the interest of this mission, which seems so absolutely to require it, to traverse for the 4th time the dangerous American desert. If heaven preserves me, for I have to travel through a region infested by thousands of hostile savages, I will send you the account of this last journey. You see, then, Reverend Father, that in these deserts we must more than ever keep our souls prepared to render the fearful account, in consequence of the perils that surround us. And as it would be desirable that we could be replaced immediately, in case of any accident occurring, again I say to you, pray that the Lord may send us fellow laborers. Rogate ergo Dominum missis ut mittat operios in messem suam. And thousands of souls who would otherwise be lost will bless you one day in eternity. Reverend Father Point has expressed a desire to be sent amongst the Blackfeet. Until they are willing to listen to the word of God, which I think will be before long, he intends to preach the gospel to the Pointed Hearts and the neighboring tribes. I trust we shall be able to make as cheering a report of these as we have already done of our first neophytes. I have found them all in the best dispositions. the Reverend Father Mangarini remains with the Flatheads and Ponds d'Oreilles. On my first journey in the autumn of 1841, which ended at Fort Colville, I baptized 190 persons of the Kalispell tribe. On my visit last spring to the various distant tribes, of which I have just finished giving you the account, I had the consolation of baptizing 418 persons, 60 of whom were of the Ponds d'Oreilles tribe of the Great Lake, 82 of the Kootenays or Skalzi, 100 of the Pointed Hearts, 56 of the Shuyelpi, 106 of the Okanagans, and 14 of the Okanagans and Walla Walla forts. These, with 500 baptized last year in different parts of the country, mostly among the Flatheads and Kalispells, and 196 that I baptized on Christmas Day at St. Mary's, with the 350 baptized by Reverend Fathers Mangarini and Point, make a total of 1,654 souls, wrested from the power of the devil. For what the Scripture calls the spirit of the world has not wherewith to introduce itself amongst them. These poor people find their happiness, even in this world, in the constant practice of their Christian duties. We may almost say of them that all who are baptized are saved. Since God has inspired you with a zealous desire to second the views of the Association for the Propagation of the Faith, entreat those pious persons to whom you may communicate your designs to redouble their prayers in our behalf. I conclude by beseeching you earnestly to remember me frequently and fervently in the Holy Sacrifice. I remain, very reverend and dear Father, your affectionate servant and brother in Christ, P. J. De Smet, S. J. End of Book 2, Part 5. Letter 14 of De Smet's Letters and Sketches, 1841-1842, by Father Pierre-Jean De Smet. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. St. Mary, June 28, 1842. Reverend Father, thanks be to God, our hopes have at length begun to be realized. The tender blossom has been succeeded by precious fruit, daily more and more visible in our colony. The chief and people, by their truly edifying conduct, give us already the sweetest consolation. Pentecost was for us and for our beloved neophytes a day of blessings, of holy exaltation. 80 of them enjoyed the happiness of partaking for the first time of the bread of angels. Their assiduity in assisting during a month at the instructions we gave them, 3 times a day, had assured us of their zeal and favor. But a retreat of 3 days, which served as a more immediate preparation, contributed still more to convince us of their sincerity. From an early hour in the morning, repeated discharges of musketry announced afar the arrival of the great, the glorious day. At the first sound of the bell, a crowd of savages hurried towards our church. One of our fathers, in a surplice and stole, preceded by 3 choristers, one of whom bore aloft the banner of the Sacred Heart of Jesus, went out to receive them and conduct them in procession, and to the sound of joyous canticles, into the temple of the Lord. What piety, what religious recollection amidst that throng! They observed a strict silence, but at the same time the joy and gladness that filled their hearts shone on their happy countenances. The ardent love which already animated these innocent hearts was inflamed afresh by the fervent aspirations to the adorable sacrament, which were recited aloud by one of our fathers, who also intermingled occasionally some stanzas of canticles. The tender devotion and the profound faith with which these Indians received their God really edified and affected us. That morning at 11 o'clock they renewed their baptismal vows, and in the afternoon they made the solemn consecration of their hearts to the Blessed Virgin, the tutelar patroness of this place. May these pious sentiments, which the true religion alone could inspire, be preserved amongst our dear children. We hope for their continuance, and what increases our hope is that at the time of this solemnity, about 120 persons approached the tribunal of penance, and since that truly memorable occasion, we have from 30 to 40 communions, and from 50 to 60 confessions every Sunday. The feast of Corpus Christi was solemnized by another ceremony not less touching, and calculated to perpetuate the gratitude and devotion of our pious Indians towards our amiable Queen. This was the solemn erection of a statue to the Blessed Virgin in memory of her apparition to little Paul. The following is a brief account of the ceremony. From the entrance of our chapel to the spot where little Paul received such a favor, the avenue was simply the greensward, the length of which on both sides was bordered by garlands hung in festoons. Triumphal arches, gracefully arranged, arose at regular distances. At the end of the avenue, and in the middle of a kind of repository, stood the pedestal, which was destined to receive the statue. The hour specified having struck, the procession issued from the chapel in this order. At the head was borne aloft the banner of the Sacred Heart, followed closely by little Paul carrying the statue, and accompanied by two choristers, who profusely strewed the way with flowers. Then came the two fathers, one vested in a cope, and the other in a surplice. Finally, the march was closed by the chiefs and all the members of the colony emulating each other in their zeal to pay their tribute of thanksgiving and praise to their Blessed Mother. When they reached the spot, one of our fathers, in a short exhortation, in which he reminded them of the signal prodigy and assistance of the Queen of Heaven, encouraged our dear neophytes to sentiments of confidence in the protection of Mary. After this address and the singing of the Litany of the Blessed Virgin, the procession returned in the same order to the church. Oh, how ardently we desired that all the friends of our holy religion could have witnessed the devotion and recollection of these new children of Mary. It was also our intention not to dismiss them until we had given them the benediction of the Blessed Sacrament. But unfortunately, not possessing a remonstrance, we were obliged to defer this beautiful ceremony until the Feast of the Sacred Heart of Jesus. At that time, the Sacred Host was carried in solemn procession, and since then, each Sunday after Vespers, the faithful enjoy the happiness of receiving the benediction. May the blessing of God really descend upon us and our colony. We hope for it through the assistance of your prayers and those of all our friends. I remain, Reverend Father, your very humble friend and servant, Greg Mangarini, S.J. End of letter 14. Letter 15 from F.N. Blanchet of De Smet's Letters and Sketches, 1841 to 1842, by Father Pierre-Jean De Smet. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Fort Vancouver, 28th September, 1841. Reverend Father, blessed be the divine providence of the all-powerful God who has protected, preserved, and restored you safely to your dear neophytes. I congratulate the country upon the inestimable treasure it possesses by the arrival and establishment therein of the members of the Society of Jesus. Be so kind as to express to the Reverend Fathers and Brothers my profound veneration and respect for them. I beg of God to bless your labors and to continue your successful efforts. In a few years you will enjoy the glory and consolation of beholding, through your means, all the savages residing on the headwaters of the Columbia, ranging themselves under the standard of the cross. I do not doubt but that our excellent governor, Dr. McLaughlin, will give you all the assistance in his power. It is very fortunate for our holy religion that this noble-hearted man should be at the head of the affairs of the Honorable Hudson Bay Company, west of the Rocky Mountains. He protected it before our arrival in these regions. He still gives it his support by word and example and many favors. As we are in the same country, aiming at the same end, namely, the triumph of the Holy Catholic Faith throughout this vast territory, the Reverend Mr. Demers and myself will always take the most lively interest in your welfare and progress, and we are convinced that whatever concerns us will equally interest you. The following is an account of our present situation. The Catholic establishment of the Willamette consists of nearly 80 families, the one at Cowlitz of only 5, 22 at Nesqually on Puget Sound, which is from 25 to 30 leagues above Cowlitz. Besides these stations, we visit from time to time the nearest forts, where the Catholics in the service of the Hudson Bay Company reside. This is what takes up almost all our time. We are much in want of lay brothers and nuns, of schoolmasters and mistresses. We have to attend to every spiritual as well as temporal affair, which is a great burden to us. The wives of the Canadians, taken from every quarter of the country, cause throughout the families a diversity of languages. They speak, almost generally, a rude jargon of which we can scarcely make any use in our public instructions. Hence proceed the obstacles to our progress. We go along slowly. We are obliged to teach them French and their catechism together, which occasions much delay. We are really overwhelmed with business. The savages apply to us from all sides. Some of them are indifferent, and we have not time to instruct them. We make them occasionally hasty visits and baptize the children and the adults who happen to be in danger of death, but we have no time to learn their languages, and until now have been without an interpreter to translate the prayers we wish them to learn. It is only lately that I have succeeded in translating them into the Chinook language. Our difficulties are greatly increased by this variety of languages. Each of the following tribes has a different dialect: the Kalapuyas towards the headwaters of the Willamette, the Chinooks of the Columbia River, the Kaijos from Walla Walla, the Pierced Noses, Okanagans, Flatheads, Snakes, Cowlitz, the Klickitats from the interior north of Vancouver, the Chehalis to the north of the mouth of the Columbia River, the Nesqualis and those from the interior or of the Puget Sound Bay, those of the Traverse River, the Kalams of the above-mentioned bay, those of Vancouver Island, and those from the northern posts on the seashore and from the interior of the part of the country watered by the tributary streams of the Traverse River. All have their different languages. Such are the difficulties we have daily to overcome. Our hearts bleed at the sight of so many souls who are lost under our eyes, without our being able to carry to them the word of life. Moreover, our temporal resources are limited. We are but two, and our trunks did not arrive last spring by the vessel belonging to the Honorable Hudson Bay Company. We have exhausted our means. The savages, women and children, ask us in vain for rosaries. We have no more catechisms of the diocese left to distribute among them, no English prayer books for the Catholic Irish, no controversial books to lend. Heaven appears to be deaf to our prayers, supplications, and most ardent wishes. You can judge of our situation and how much we are to be pitied. We are in the meantime surrounded by sects who are using all their efforts to scatter everywhere the poisonous seeds of error, and who try to paralyze the little good we may effect. The Methodists are first at Willamette, which is about 8 miles from my establishment, second near the Clatrops, south of the mouth of the Columbia River, third at Nesqually or Puget Sound, fourth at the Great Dalles, south of Walla Walla, and fifth at the Willamette Falls. The Presbyterian missions are at Walla Walla, as you approach Colville. In the midst of so many adversaries, we try to keep our ground firmly. To increase our numbers and to visit various parts, particularly where the danger is most pressing, we also endeavor to anticipate the others and to inculcate the Catholic principles in those places where error has not as yet found a footing, or even to arrest the progress of evil, to dry it up at its source. The conflict has been violent, but the savages now begin to open their eyes as to who are the real ministers of Jesus Christ. Heaven declares itself in our favor. If we had a priest to hold a permanent station amongst the savages, the country would be ours in 2 years. The Methodist missions are failing rapidly. They are losing their credit and the little influence they possessed. By the grace of God, our cause has prevailed at Willamette. This spring, Mr. Demers withdrew from the Methodists a whole village of savages situate at the foot of the Willamette Falls. Mr. Demers also visited the Chinook below the Columbia River. They are well disposed towards Catholicity. I have just arrived from Cascades, which is 18 leagues from Vancouver. The savages at this place had resisted all the insinuations of a pretended minister. It was my first mission and only lasted 10 days. They learned in that time the sign of the cross, the offering of their hearts to God, the Lord's Prayer, the angelical salutation, the Apostles' Creed, the Ten Commandments, and those of the Church. I intend to revisit them soon near Vancouver and to baptize a considerable number. Reverend Mr. Demers has been absent these 2 months on a visit to the savages at the Bay of Puget Sound, who have long since besought him to come amongst them. I have not been able to visit since the month of May my catechumens at Flacamar, a village whose people were converted last spring and who had turned a deaf ear to Mr. Waller, who is established at Willamette. Judge then, sir, how great are our labors and how much it would advance our mutual interest were you to send hither one of your reverend fathers with one of the 3 lay brothers. In my opinion, it is on this spot that we must seek to establish our holy religion. It is here that we should have a college, convent, and schools. It is here that one day a successor of the apostles will come from some part of the world to settle and provide for the spiritual necessities of this vast region, which, moreover, promises such an abundant harvest. Here is the field of battle where we must, in the first place, gain the victory. It is here that we must establish a beautiful mission. From the lower stations, the missionaries and reverend fathers could go forth in all directions to supply the distant stations and announce the word of God to the infidels still plunged in darkness and the shadows of death. If your plans should not permit you to change the place of your establishment, at least take into consideration the need in which we stand of a reverend father and of a lay brother to succor us in our necessities. By the latest dates from the Sandwich Islands, I am informed that the Reverend Mr. Chaussure has arrived there and accompanied by 3 priests, the Reverend Mr. Walsh making the 4th. A large Catholic church, it was hoped, would have been ready last autumn for the celebration of the Holy Mysteries. The natives were embracing our everlasting faith in great numbers, and the meeting-houses were almost abandoned. The Bishop of Juliopolis, stationed at Red River, writes to me that the savages dwelling near the base of the eastern part of the Rocky Mountains have deputed to him a half-blood who resides amongst them to obtain from his grace a priest to instruct them. Reverend Mr. Thibault is destined for this mission. I remain, Reverend Father, yours, F. N. Blanchet. End of letter 15. Letter 16 of De Smet's Letters and Sketches, 1841 to 1842, by Father Pierre-Jean De Smet. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. University of St. Louis, 1st November, 1842. Very Reverend Father, in my last letter of August, I promised to write to you from St. Louis, should I arrive safely in that city. Heaven has preserved me, and here I am, about to fulfill my promise. Leaving Reverend Father Point and the Flathead Camp on the River Madison, I was accompanied by 12 of our Indians. We traveled in 3 days, a distance of 150 miles, crossing 2 chains of mountains. in a section of country frequently visited by the Blackfeet warriors, without, however, meeting with any of these scalping savages. At the mouth of the 25-yard river, a branch of the Yellowstone, we found 250 huts belonging to several nations, all friendly to us: the Flatheads, Kalispels, Pierced Noses, Cayuses, and Snakes. I spent 3 days amongst them to exhort them to perseverance and to make some preparations for my long journey. The day of my departure, 10 neophytes presented themselves at my lodge to serve as my escort and to introduce me to the Crow tribe. On the evening of the second day, we were in the midst of this large and interesting tribe. The Crows had perceived us from a distance. As we approached, some of them recognized me, and at the cry of, "The Black Gown! The Black Gown!" the Crows, young and old, to the number of 3,000, came out of their wigwams. On entering the village, a comical scene occurred, of which they suddenly made me the principal personage. All the chiefs, and about 50 of their warriors, hastened around me, and I was literally assailed by them. Holding me by the gown, they drew me in every direction, whilst a robust savage of gigantic stature seemed resolved to carry me off by main force. All spoke at the same time, and appeared to be quarreling, whilst I, the sole object of all this contention, could not conceive what they were about. I remained passive, not knowing whether I should laugh or be serious. The interpreter soon came to my relief and said that all this uproar was but an excess of politeness and kindness towards me, as everyone wished to have the honor of lodging and entertaining the Black Gown. With his advice, I selected my host, upon which the others immediately loosed their hold, and I followed the chief to his lodge, which was the largest and best in the camp. The Crows did not tarry long before they all gathered around me and loaded me with marks of kindness. The social calumet, emblem of savage brotherhood and union, went round that evening so frequently that it was scarcely ever extinguished. It was accompanied with all the antics for which the Crows are so famous, when they offer the calumet to the Great Spirit, to the four winds, to the sun, fire, earth, and water. These Indians are unquestionably the most anxious to learn, the most inquisitive, ingenious, and polished of all the savage tribes east of the mountains. They profess great friendship and admiration for the whites. They asked me innumerable questions. Among others, they wished to know the number of the whites. "Count," I replied, "the blades of grass upon your immense plains, and you will know, pretty nearly, the number of the whites." They all smiled, saying that the thing was impossible, but they understood my meaning. And when I explained to them the vast extent of the villages inhabited by white men, viz. New York, Philadelphia, London, Paris, the grand lodges, houses, built as near each other as the fingers of my hand, and four or five piled up one above the other, meaning the different stories of our dwellings, when I told them that some of these lodges, speaking of churches and towers, were as high as mountains and large enough to contain all the Crows together, that in the Grand Lodge of the National Council, the capital at Washington, all the great chiefs of the whole world could smoke the calumet at their ease, that the roads in these great villages were always filled with passengers who came and went more thickly than the vast herds of buffaloes that sometimes cover their beautiful plains. When I explained to them the extraordinary celerity of those moving lodges, the cars on the railroad, that leave far behind them the swiftest horse, and which are drawn along by frightful machines, whose repeated groanings re-echo far and wide as they belch forth immense volumes of fire and smoke, and next those fire canoes, steamboats, which transport whole villages with provisions, arms, and baggage in a few days from one country to another, crossing large lakes, the seas, ascending and descending the great rivers and streams. When I told them that I had seen white men mounting up into the air in balloons and flying with as much agility as the warrior eagle of their mountains, then their astonishment was at its height, and all, placing their hands upon their mouths, sent forth at the same time one general cry of wonder. "The Master of Life is great," said the chief, "and the white men are his favorites." But what appeared to interest them more than aught else was prayer, religion. To this subject they listened with the strictest undivided attention. They told me that they had already heard of it, and they knew that this prayer made men good and wise on earth, and ensured their happiness in the future life. They begged me to permit the whole camp to assemble, that they might hear for themselves the words of the Great Spirit, of whom they had been told such wonders. Immediately, three United States flags were erected on the field in the midst of the camp, and 3,000 savages, including the sick, who were carried in skins, gathered around me. I knelt beneath the banner of our country, my 10 flathead neophytes by my side, and surrounded by this multitude, eager to hear the glad tidings of the gospel of peace. We began by intoning two canticles, after which I recited all the prayers, which we interpreted to them. Then again we sang canticles, and I finished by explaining to them the Apostles' Creed and the 10 Commandments. They all appeared to be filled with joy, and declared it was the happiest day of their lives. They begged me to have pity on them, to remain among them, and instruct them and their little children in the knowledge, love, and service of the Great Spirit. I promised that a black gown should visit them, but on condition that the chiefs would engage themselves to put a stop to the thievish practices so common amongst them, and to oppose vigorously the corrupt morals of their tribe. Believing me to be endowed with supernatural powers, they had entreated me from the very commencement of our conversation to free them from the sickness that then desolated the camp, and to supply them with plenty. I repeated to them on this occasion that the Great Spirit alone could remove these evils. God, I said, listens to the supplications of the good and pure of heart, of those who detest their sins and wish to devote themselves to his service. But he shuts his ears to the prayers of those who violate his holy law. In his anger, God had destroyed by fire 5 infamous villages, Sodom, Gomorrah, etc., in consequence of their horrid abominations, that the crows walked in the ways of these wicked men. Consequently, they could not complain if the Great Spirit seemed to punish them by sickness, war, and famine. They were themselves the authors of all their calamities, and if they did not change their mode of life very soon, they might expect to see their misfortunes increase from day to day, whilst the most awful torments awaited them and all wicked men after their death. I assured them, in fine, that heaven would be the reward of those who would repent of their evil deeds and practice the religion of the Great Spirit. The grand orator of the camp was the first to reply. "Black Gown," said he, "I understand you. You have said what is true. Your words have passed from my ears into my heart. I wish all could comprehend them." Whereon, addressing himself to the crows, he repeated forcibly, "Yes, crows, the black gown has said what is true. We are dogs, for we live like dogs. Let us change our lives, and our children will live." I then held long conferences with all the chiefs assembled in council. I proposed to them the example of the Flatheads and Ponds d'Arrées, whose chiefs made it their duty to exhort their people to the practice of virtue, and who knew how to punish as they deserved all the prevarications against God's holy law. They promised to follow my advice, and assured me that I would find them in better dispositions on my return. I flatter myself with the hope that this visit, the good example of my neophytes, but principally the prayers of the Flatheads, will gradually produce a favorable change among the crows. A good point in their character, and one that inspires me with almost the certainty of their amendment, is that they have hitherto resisted courageously all attempts to introduce spirituous liquors among them. "For what is this firewater good?" said the chief to a white man who tried to bring it into their country. "It burns the throat and stomach. It makes a man like a bear who has lost his senses. He bites, he growls, he scratches, and he howls. He falls down as if he were dead. Your firewater does nothing but harm. Take it to our enemies, and they will kill each other, and their wives and children will be worthy of pity. As for us, we do not want it. We are fools enough without it." A very touching scene occurred during the council. Several of the savages wished to examine my missionary cross. I thence took occasion to explain to them the sufferings of our Savior Jesus Christ and the cause of his death on the cross. I then placed my cross in the hands of the great chief. He kissed it in the most respectful manner, raising his eyes to heaven and pressing the cross with both his hands to his heart. He exclaimed, "O Great Spirit, take pity on me, and be merciful to thy poor children." And his people followed his example. I was in the village of the Crows when news was brought that two of their most distinguished warriors had fallen victims to the rage and cruelty of the Blackfeet. The heralds, or orators, went round the camp, proclaiming in a loud voice the circumstances of the combat and the tragic end of the two brave men. A gloomy silence prevailed everywhere, only interrupted by a band of mourners, whose appearance alone was enough to make the most insensible heart bleed, and rouse to vengeance the entire nation. This band was composed of the mothers of the two unfortunate warriors who had fallen, their wives carrying their newborn infants in their arms, their sisters, and all their little children. The unhappy creatures had their heads shaven and cut in every direction. They were gashed with innumerable wounds, whence the blood constantly trickled. In this pitiable state they rent the air with their lamentations and cries, imploring the warriors of their nation to have compassion on them, to have compassion on their desolate children, to grant them one last favor, the only cure for their affliction, and that was to go at once and inflict signal vengeance on the murderers. They led by the bridle all the horses that belonged to the deceased. A Crow chief, mounting immediately the best of these steeds, brandished his tomahawk in the air, proclaiming that he was ready to avenge the deed. Several young men rallied about him. They sung together the war song and started the same day, declaring that they would not return empty-handed, viz., without scalps. On these occasions, the near relations of the one who has fallen distribute everything that they possess, retaining nothing but some old rags wherewith to clothe themselves. The mourning ceases as soon as the deed is avenged. The warriors cast at the feet of the widows and orphans the trophies torn away from the enemies. Then, passing from extreme grief to exultation, they cast aside their tattered garments, wash their bodies, besmear themselves with all sorts of colors, deck themselves off in their best robes, and with the scalps affixed to the end of poles, march in triumph around the camp, shouting and dancing, accompanied at the same time by the whole village. On the 29th, I bade adieu to my faithful companions, the Flatheads, and the Crows. Accompanied by Ignatius, Gabriel, and by two brave Americans, who, although Protestants, wished to serve as guides to a Catholic missionary, I once more plunged into the arid plains of the Yellowstone. Having already described this region, I have nothing new to add concerning it. This desert is undoubtedly dangerous, and has been the scene of more tragic deeds, combats, stratagems, and savage cruelties than any other region. At each step, the Crow interpreter, Mr. V.C., who had sojourned 11 years in the country, recounted different transactions, pointing meanwhile to the spots where they had occurred, which in our situation made our blood run cold and our hair stand erect. It is the battleground where the Crows, the Blackfeet, Sioux, Cheyennes, Assiniboines, Arikaras, and Minnetarees fight out their interminable quarrels, avenging and revenging without respite their mutual wrongs. After 6 days' march, we found ourselves upon the very spot where a combat had recently taken place. The bloody remains of 10 Assiniboines, who had been slain, were scattered here and there, almost all the flesh eaten off by the wolves and carnivorous birds. At the sight of these mangled limbs, of the vultures that soared above our heads after having satiated themselves with the unclean repast, and the region round me, which had so lately resounded with the savage cries of more savage men engaged in mutual carnage, I own that the little courage I thought I possessed seemed to fail me entirely and give place to a secret terror which I sought in vain to stifle or conceal from my companions. We observed in several places the fresh tracks of men and horses, leaving no doubt in our minds as to the proximity of hostile parties. Our guide even assured me that he thought we were already discovered, but by continuing our precautions, he hoped we might perhaps elude their craftiness and malicious designs, for the savages very seldom make their attacks in open day. The following is the description of our regular march until the 10th of September. At daybreak, we saddled our horses and pursued our journey. At 10 a.m. we breakfasted in a suitable place that would offer some advantage in case of an attack. After an hour and a half or 2 hours' rest, we resumed our march a second time, always trotting our horses, until sunset, when we unsaddled them to dine and sup. We then lighted a good fire, hastily raised a little cabin of branches to induce our ever-watchful foes, in case they pursue us, to suppose that we had encamped for the night, for as soon as the inimical videttes discovered anything of the kind, they make it known by a signal to the whole party. They then immediately assemble and concert the plan of attack. In the meantime, favored by the darkness, we pursued our journey quietly until 10 or 12 at night, and then, without fire or even shelter, each one disposed himself as well as he might for sleep. It appears to me that I hear you ask, but what did you eat for your breakfast and supper? Examine the notes of my journal, and you will acknowledge that our fare was such as would excite the envy of the most fastidious gastronome. From the 25th of August to the 10th of September, 1842, we killed, to supply our wants as we journeyed on, 3 fine buffalo cows and 2 large bulls, only to obtain the tongue and marrow bones, 2 large deer, as fat as we could have wished, 3 goats, 2 black-tail deer, a bighorn or mountain sheep, 2 fine gray bears, and a swan, to say nothing of the pheasants, fowls, snipes, ducks, and geese. In the midst of so much game, we scarcely felt the want of bread, sugar, or coffee. The haunches, tongues, and ribs replaced these. And the bed? It is soon arranged. We were in a country where you lose no time in taking off your shoes. You wrap your buffalo robe around you. The saddle serves as a pillow, and thanks to the fatigues of a long journey of about 40 miles, under a burning sun, you have scarcely laid your head upon it before you are asleep. The gentlemen of Fort Union, at the mouth of the Yellowstone, received me with great politeness and kindness. I rested there during 3 days. A journey so long and continuous through regions where the drought had been so great that every sign of vegetation had disappeared had very much exhausted our poor horses. The 1,800 miles that we had yet to travel were not to be undertaken lightly. After having well considered everything, I resolved to leave my horses at the fort and to trust myself to the impetuous waters of the Missouri in a skiff, accompanied by Ignatius and Gabriel. The result was most fortunate, for on the third day of our descent, to our great surprise and joy, we heard the puffing of a steamboat. It was a real godsend to us. Accordingly, our first thought was to thank God in all the sincerity of our hearts. We soon beheld her majestically ascending the stream. It was the first boat that had ever attempted to ascend the river in that season of the year. Laden with merchandise were the Fur Trade Company. Four gentlemen from New York, proprietors of the boat, invited me to enter and remain on board. I accepted, with unfeigned gratitude, their kind offer of hospitality, the more so as they assured me that several parties of warriors were lying in ambush along the river. On entering the boat, I was an object of great curiosity. My black gown, my missionary cross, my long hair attracted attention. I had thousands of questions to answer, and many long stories to relate about my journey. I have but a few words to add. The waters were low, and the sandbanks and snags everywhere numerous. The boat consequently encountered many obstacles in her passage. We were frequently in great danger of perishing. Her keel was pierced by pointed rocks, her sides rent by the snags. 20 times the wheels had been broken to pieces. The pilot's house had been carried away in the tempest. The whole cabin would have followed if it had not been made fast by a large cable. Our boat appeared to be little more than a mere wreck, and in this wreck, after 46 days' navigation from the Yellowstone, we arrived safely at St. Louis. On the last Sunday of October, at 12 o'clock, I was kneeling at the foot of St. Mary's altar in the cathedral, offering up my thanksgiving to God for the signal protection he had extended to his poor, unworthy servant. From the beginning of April, I had traveled 5,000 miles. I had descended and ascended the dangerous Columbia River. I had seen 5 of my companions perish in one of those life-destroying whirlpools, so justly dreaded by those who navigate that stream. I had traversed the Willamette, crossed the Rocky Mountains, passed through the country of the Blackfeet, the desert of the Yellowstone, and descended the Missouri, and in all these journeys I had not received the slightest injury. Dominus memor fuit nostri et benedixit nobis. I recommend myself to your good prayers and have the honor to remain your very humble and obedient son in Jesus Christ, P. J. de Smet, S.J. End of letter 16. End of de Smet's Letters and Sketches, 1841 to 1842, by Father Pierre Jean de Smet. Read by Carol Pelster.